Kings. Lecture. By Lawrence Gardner. Whereas the research for this book's predecessor, Bloodline of the Holy Grail, was New Testament-based, Genesis of the Grail Kings concentrates on Old Testament times, particularly on the early stories from the books of Genesis and Exodus. As discovered in previous studies, the gospel texts which have been in the public domain for centuries often bear little relation to the first-hand accounts of the era to which they relate. The New Testament, as we know it, was contrived by the 4th-century bishops to support the newly manipulated Christian faith and, in just the same way, the Old Testament scriptures were designed to uphold the emergent Hebrew faith, rather than to represent historical fact. Clearly, one has to get back to the pre-biblical writings in order to find any anomalies, but the problem in scriptural terms is that the earliest Hebrew writings, which were restructured many centuries later, were themselves only written between the 6th and the 1st centuries BC, so they are not likely to be wholly authentic in their telling of accounts from thousands of years before. Indeed, it is plain that this is the case because, when these books were first written, their express purpose was to convey the history of a religion which did not actually emerge until well into the ancestral story. The Bible explains that the bloodline story began with Adam and Eve, from whose 3rd son Seth evolved a line which progressed through Methuselah, Noah and, eventually, to Abraham who became the great patriarch of the Hebrew nation. The text relates that Abraham brought his family westwards out of Mesopotamia, present-day Iraq, to the land of Canaan, Palestine, from where some of his descendants moved into Egypt. After many generations, they journeyed back into Canaan where, in time, David of Bethlehem became king of the newly defined kingdoms of Judah and Israel. If viewed as it is presented in the scriptures, this is a fascinating saga, but there is nothing anywhere to indicate why the ancestral line of David and his subsequent heirs was in any way special. In fact, quite the reverse is the case. His ancestors are portrayed as a succession of wandering territory seekers, who are seen to be of no particular significance until the time of King David himself. Their biblical history bears no comparison to, say, the contemporary pharaohs of ancient Egypt, but their significance, we are told, comes from the fact that Abraham and his descendants were designated as God's chosen people. This, of course, leaves us wondering because, according to the Old Testament, their God led them through nothing but a succession of famines, wars, and general hardship, rather than acting throughout as their merciful shepherd, an image which is only portrayed from time to time. Given that the first group of these ultimately canonical books was written while the Jews were held captive in Mesopotamian Babylon in the 6th century BC, it is apparent that Babylon was where the original records were then held. In fact, from the time of Adam, through some 19 set generations down to Abraham, the whole of Hebrew patriarchal history was Mesopotamian. More specifically, the history was from Sumer in southern Mesopotamia, where the ancient Sumerians did indeed refer to the grasslands of the Euphrates Delta as the Eden. When researching for Bloodline of the Holy Grail, it was apparent that good sources for background information were the various Gospels and texts that were not selected by the bishops for inclusion in the canonical New Testament, the books that were strategically ignored. Similarly, there were books that were excluded from the Old Testament, the books of Enoch and Jubilees, for example. A further work, to which attention is specifically drawn in the Old Testament books of Joshua and 2 Samuel, is the book of Jasher. But despite Jasher's apparent importance to the Hebrew writers, it was not included in the final selection. Also, the book of Numbers draws our attention to the book of the wars of Jehovah, while in the book of Isaiah we are directed towards the book of the Lord. The very fact that these writings are mentioned in the Bible means that they must predate the Old Testament. Indeed, they are all cited as being important but, for one reason or another, the editors saw fit to exclude them when the canonical selection was made. It has often been wondered why the biblical God of the Hebrews led them through trials, tribulations, floods and disaster when, from time to time, he appears to have performed with a quite contrary and merciful personality. The answer is that, although now seemingly embraced in a general context as the one God by the Jewish and Christian churches, there was originally a distinct difference between the figures of Jehovah and the Lord. They were, in practice, quite separate deities. The God referred to as Jehovah was traditionally a storm god, a god of wrath and vengeance, whereas the God referred to as the Lord emerges as a god of fertility and wisdom. In early times, the prevailing Hebrew word for Lord was Adon, whereas the apparent personal name of Jehovah was not used at all. It came from the original Hebrew stem Yahweh, Yahweh, which meant I am that I am, a statement said to have been made by God to Moses on Mount Sinai hundreds of years after the time of Abraham. However, the Bible also makes it clear that the God of Abraham was actually called El Shaddai, which means lofty mountain. Jehovah was, therefore, not a name at all. The early texts refer simply to El Shaddai and to his opposing counterpart Adon. The Canaanites called these gods El Elyon and Baal, meaning precisely the same things, lofty mountain and Lord. In modern Bibles, the definitions God and Lord are used and intermixed throughout as if they referred to the same Jehovah character, but originally they did not. One was a vengeful God, a people suppressor, and the other was a social God, a people supporter. Additionally, in contrast to Bible teachings, the various traditions relate that these gods both had parents, wives, sons, and daughters. Throughout the patriarchal era, the emergent Hebrews endeavored to support Adon the Lord, but, at every turn, El Shaddai, the storm god Jehovah, retaliated with floods, tempests, famines, and general destruction. Even at the time of the captivity, around 586 BC, the Bible explains that Jerusalem was overthrown at Jehovah's bidding. Tens of thousands of Israelites were then taken hostage into Babylon simply because one of their past kings, a descendant of King David, had erected altars in veneration of Baal the Adon. It was during the course of this captivity that the Israelites finally conceded. They decided, after generations of Adon support, to succumb to the opposing God of wrath, developing a new religion out of sheer fear of his retribution. It was, in fact, at this time that the apparent name of Jehovah first appeared, little more than 500 years before the time of Jesus. Subsequently, the Christian Church took Jehovah on board as well, calling him simply God, and all the hitherto social concepts of Adon were totally discarded. The two religions were henceforth both faiths of fear, and even today their followers are classified as God-fearing. This leaves us with the knowledge that, within an overall pantheon of gods and goddesses, many of whom are actually named in the Bible, there were two predominant and opposing gods. In different cultures they have been called El Elyon and Baal, El Shaddai and Adon, Ahriman and Mazda, Jehovah and Lord, God and Father, but these styles are not personal names, they are all titular definitions. To discover the identities of these gods, we have to look no further than where they were first recorded as being operative. In this regard, ancient Canaanite texts, discovered in Syria in the 1920s, reveal that their respective courts were in the Tigris-Euphrates Valley in Mesopotamian Sumer, above the Eden Delta of the Persian Gulf. Sumerian written records can be traced back to the 3rd millennium BC and they explain that the gods in question were brothers. In Sumer, the storm god who eventually became known as Jehovah was called Enlil or Ilakur Gal, meaning lofty one of the mountain, and his brother, who became Adon the Lord, was called Enki, a very appropriate name because Enki means archetype. The texts inform us that it was Enlil who brought the flood, it was Enlil who destroyed Ur and Babylon, and it was Enlil who constantly opposed the education and enlightenment of humankind. Indeed, an early Syrian text relates that it was Enlil Jehovah who obliterated the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah on the Dead Sea, not because they were dens of wickedness as is generally taught, but because they were great centers of wisdom and learning. It was Enki, on the other hand, who, despite the vengeful wrath of his brother, granted the Sumerians access to the Tree of Knowledge and the Tree of Life. It was Enki who set up the escape strategy during the flood, and it was Enki who passed over the time-honored tables of destiny, the tablets of scientific law which became the bedrock of the early mystery schools in Egypt. Many books mention the Hermetic school of Pharaoh Thutmose III, who reigned about 1450 BC, but it is not generally known that the school he inherited was the original court of the dragon, founded by the priests of Mendes in about 2200 BC. It was later ratified by the 12th dynasty Queen Sobenefru as a sovereign and priestly order, to be eventually passed from Egypt to the kings of Jerusalem and the Black Sea princes of Scythia. Around 600 years ago, King Sigismund of Hungary reconstituted the order, which exists today as the imperial and royal court of the dragon sovereignty under the auspices of the House of Vere of Anjou. The kings of the early succession, who reigned in Sumer and Egypt before becoming kings of Israel, were anointed upon installation with the fat of the dragon, the sacred crocodile. This noble beast was referred to in Egypt as the Messeh, from which derived the Hebrew verb to anoint, and the kings of this dynastic succession were referred to as dragons or messiahs, meaning anointed ones. In times of conflict, when the armies of different kingdoms were conjoined, an overall leader was chosen and he was called the Great Dragon, the King of Kings, or, as we better know the name in its old Celtic form, the Pendragon. An interesting aspect of the word kingship is that it was identical with kinship, and kin means blood relative. In its original form, kinship was kainship, and the first king of the messianic succession was the biblical Cain, head of the Sumerian house of Kish. On recognizing this, one can immediately see an early anomaly in the traditional Genesis story, for the historical line to David and Jesus was not from Adam and Eve's son Seth at all. It was from Eve's son Cain, whose recorded successors, although given little space in the Old Testament, were the first great kings of Mesopotamia and Egypt. Two more important features then come to light when reading the Bible with this knowledge in mind. Conventional teaching generally cites Cain as being the first son of Adam and Eve, but he was not. Even the book of Genesis tells us that he was not. In fact, it confirms how Eve told Adam that Cain's father was the Lord, who was of course Enki the archetype. Even outside the Bible, the writings of the Hebrew Talmud and Midrash make it quite plain that Cain was not the son of Adam. So what else is wrongly taught about this particular aspect of history? The book of Genesis, in its English translated form, tells us that Cain was a tiller of the ground, but this is not what the original texts say at all. What they say is that Cain had dominion over the earth, which is a rather different matter when considering his kingly status. The Bible translators appear to have had a constant problem with the word earth, often translating it to ground, clay or dust, instead of recognizing it as relating to the earth. Even in the case of Adam and Eve, the translators made glaring errors. The Bible says, "Male and female created he them, and he called their name Adam." Older writings use the more complete word Adama, which means of the earth. However, this did not mean they were made of dirt. It means, as the Anchor Hebrew Bible explains in precise terms, that they were earthlings. Around 6,000 years ago, Adam and Eve, known then as Adaba and Kava, and jointly called the Adama, were purpose-bred for kingship by Enki and his sister wife Ninkursag. This took place at a creation chamber which the Sumerian annals refer to as the House of Shimti, Shimti meaning breath, wind, life. Adam and Eve were certainly not the first people on earth, but they were the first of the alchemically devised kingly succession. Ninkursag was called the Lady of the Embryo or the Lady of Life, and she was the surrogate mother for Adaba and Kava, who were created from human ova fertilized by the Lord Enki. It was because of Ninkursag's title, Lady of Life, that Kava was later given the same distinction by the Hebrews. Indeed, the name Kava, Ava or Eve, was subsequently said to mean life. There is an interesting parallel here because, in Sumerian, the style Lady of Life was Ninti, Nin meaning lady, and Ti meaning life. However, another Sumerian word, Ti, with the longer pronunciation, T, meant rib, and it was by virtue of the Hebrews' misunderstanding of the two words, Ti and Ti, that Eve became incorrectly associated with Adam's rib. Both Enki and Ninkursag, along with their brother Enlil, the later Jehovah, belonged to a pantheon of gods and goddesses referred to as the Anunnaki, which, in Sumerian, means heaven came to earth, Anunnaki. In fact, the Grand Assembly of the Anunnaki, later called the Court of the Elohim, is actually mentioned in the Old Testament's Psalm number 82, wherein Jehovah makes his bid for supreme power over the other gods. According to the dragon tradition, the importance of Cain was that he was directly produced by Enki and Kaaba, so his blood was three-quarters Anunnaki, while his half-brothers, Hevel and Satanael, better known as Abel and Seth, were less than half Anunnaki, being the offspring of Adaba and Kaaba, Adam and Eve. Cain's Anunnaki blood was so advanced that it was said that his brother Abel's blood was earthbound by comparison. It was related in the scriptures that Cain rose far above Abel, so that his brother's blood was swallowed into the ground, but this original description was thoroughly misinterpreted for the modern Bible, which now claims that Cain rose up against Abel and spilled his blood upon the ground. This is not the same thing at all. The story can now be progressed by considering the oldest grant of arms in sovereign history, an entitlement which denoted the messianic dragon bloodline for all time. The Sumerians referred to this insignia as the Graal, but biblical history refers to it as the mark of Cain. This mark is portrayed by the modern church as if it were some form of curse, but it is not defined as such in the Bible. Genesis actually relates that, having got into an argument with Jehovah over a matter of sovereign observance, Cain feared for his life. Consequently, the Lord placed a mark upon Cain, swearing sevenfold vengeance against his enemies. It has never been fully understood why Jehovah should decide to protect Cain when it was he who held the grievance against him. But the fact is that Jehovah did not make this decision, the mark was settled upon Cain by the Lord, and the Lord, the Adon, was not Jehovah but Cain's own father, Enki. Few people ever think to inquire about the supposed enemies of Cain as defined in Genesis. Who could they possibly have been? Where would they have come from? According to the Bible, only Adam and Eve, along with their sons Cain and Abel, existed, and Cain had apparently killed Abel. Therefore, if one accepts the text as it stands, there was no one around to be Cain's enemy. The Sumerian Graal, which biblical tradition calls the mark of Cain, was an emblem dignified as the cup of the waters, or the Rossi Crucis, the dew cup, and it was identified in all records, including those of Egypt, Phoenicia, and the Hebrew annals, as being an upright, centered red cross within a circle. Throughout the ages it was developed and embellished, but it has always remained essentially the same and is recognized as being the original symbol of the Holy Grail. Another anomaly is presented soon afterwards in Genesis when we are told that Cain found himself a wife. Who on earth were her parents if Adam and Eve were the only couple alive? Then, without confronting this anomaly at all, Genesis proceeds to list the names of Cain's descendants. It becomes clear from all this that some very important information has been edited from the Old Testament narrative. Plainly, there were plenty of other people around at the time and it is not difficult to find their stories outside the Bible. Quite apart from the Sumerian records, even Old Hebrew and early Christian texts give far more information in this regard. In order to further enhance the historical succession from Cain, he was married to his half-sister, a purebred Anunnaki princess called Lulua. Her father was Enki and her mother was Lilith, a granddaughter of Enlil. Although not giving the name of Cain's wife, the Bible does name their younger son Enoch, Hanok, while the Sumerian records cite his elder son and kingly successor Aten, who is perhaps better known as King Aten of Kish. Aten was said to have walked with the gods and was fed from the plant of birth, or the tree of life as it is called in Genesis. Henceforth, the kings of the line were designated as being the twigs of the tree, and the ancient word for twig was clone, clone. In later times, this plant or tree was redefined as a vine, and so the Graal, the vine, and the messianic bloodline became entwined in the Holy Grail literature of subsequent ages. By virtue of their contrived breeding, this kingly succession was modeled specifically for leadership and, in all aspects of knowledge, culture, awareness, wisdom, and intuition, they were highly advanced against their mundane contemporaries. In order to keep their blood as pure as possible, they always married within a close kinship, for it was fully recognized that the prominent gene of the succession was carried within the blood of the mother. Today we call this the mitochondrial DNA. And so was born a tradition inherited by their kingly descendants in Egypt, and by the later Celtic rulers of Europe. True kingship, it was maintained, was transferred through the female, and kingly marriages were, therefore, strategically cemented with maternal half-sisters or matrilinear first cousins. Having reached the point where the plant of birth is first mentioned in the records, we are at about 3500 BC, and it is at this stage that we begin to learn how the kingly succession was orally fed with bodily supplements from the early days. This original practice continued for more than 1,000 years until the nourishment program became wholly scientific and alchemical. Before discussing the kingly diet in detail, it is worth considering why it was that the all-important blood royal, the sangreal, which progressed from Cain and his sons, was strategically ignored by the Hebrews and the Christian Church in favor of their promoting a parallel junior line from Adam's son Seth. Why was it that the immediate Cainite dynasty was eventually shunned by the fearful disciples of Enlil Jehovah? In the Old Testament book of Genesis, the lines of descent are given from Cain and from his half-brother Seth, but it is of interest to note that the names detailed in the early generations are pretty much the same in each list, although given in a different order: Enoch, Jared, Mahalalel, Methuselah, and Lamech. In view of this, it has often been suggested that the line from Seth down to Lamech's son Noah was contrived by the Bible compilers so as to avoid showing the true descent from Cain to the time of Noah. If this were the case, then something must have occurred during the lifetime of Noah to cause the ancestral story to be veiled by the later writers, as is indeed conveyed in the Bible itself. At that stage in the family's history, the vengeful Jehovah apparently warned Noah and his sons against the ingestion of blood, an edict which became expressly important to the later Hebrew way of life. It has long been a customary Jewish practice to hang meat for bloodletting before cooking and consumption, but, in contrast, the Christian faith is especially concerned with the figurative ingestion of blood. In the Christian tradition, it is customary to take the communion sacrament, the Eucharist, wherein wine is drunk from the sacred chalice, symbolically representing the blood of Jesus, the lifeblood of the messianic vine. Could it be, therefore, that the modern Christian custom is an unwitting throwback to some distant pre-Noah ritual which Jehovah opposed? If so, then since it is known that the chalice is a holy female symbol which has been emblematic of the womb from the earliest times, as discussed in Bloodline of the Holy Grail, might this messianic lifeblood, now symbolized by wine, have been an extract of menstrual blood in original times? The answer to these questions is yes, that was precisely the custom, but it was not so unsavory as it might seem. Indeed, few of us think to inquire about the ultimate sources of many of today's ingested medicines and bodily supplements, and those in the know would often be reluctant to tell us. The premarin hormone, for example, comes from the urine of pregnant Mares, while certain growth hormones and insulin are manufactured from E. coli, a fecal bacterium. The blood extract in question was, in the first instance, that of Enki's sister wife Anankur-Sag, the designated Lady of Life. It was a sacred Anunnaki essence, defined as the most potent of all life forces and venerated as being starfire. It was from the womb of Ninkursag that the royal line was born, and it was with her blood, the divine starfire, that the dragon succession was supplementally fed. In ancient Egypt, Ninkursag was called Isis and, by either name, she was the ultimate mother of the messianic line, for hers was the matrilinear gene which constituted the kingly beginning. It is worth remembering, therefore, that the biblical edict to abstain from blood came not from Enki the wise, but from Enlil Jehovah, the god of wrath and vengeance who had instigated the flood, wrought havoc in Ur and Babylon, and had endeavored to deceive Adam by saying that he would die if he ate from the tree of knowledge. This was not a god who liked people, and the Sumerian records are very clear in this regard. Hence, if he forbade the taking of blood, this was not likely to have been an edict for the benefit of Noah and his descendants, it was most probably to their detriment. In strict terms, the original starfire was the lunar essence of the goddess, but even in an everyday mundane environment, menstruum contains the most valuable endocrinal secretions, particularly those of the pineal and pituitary glands. The brain's pineal gland in particular was directly associated with the tree of life, for this tiny gland was said to secrete the very essence of active longevity, referred to as soma, or as the Greeks called it, ambrosia. In mystic circles, the menstrual flow she who flows, has long been the designated flower, and is represented as a lily or a lotus. Indeed, the definition flow is the very root of the modern word flower. In ancient Sumer, the key females of the royal succession were all venerated as lilies, having such names as Lily, Lulawa, Lilith, Lilutu, and Lilev. In pictorial representation, the messianic dragon bore little relation to the winged, fire-breathing beast of later Western mythology. It was, in essence, a large-jawed serpent with four legs, very much like a crocodile or a monitor. This was the sacred Mesa whose name was Draco. This sovereign beast was a divine emblem of the Egyptian pharaohs, a symbol of the Egyptian Therapeutate in Karnak and Qumran, while also being the Bisti Neptunese sea serpent of the descendant Merovingian fisher kings in Gaul. In old Hebrew texts, references to serpents are made by use of the word Nahash, from the stem Nhsh, but this does not relate to serpents in the way that we might perceive them as venomous snakes. It relates to serpents in their traditional capacity as bringers of wisdom and enlightenment, for the word Nahash actually meant to decipher, or to find out. Serpents, in one form or another, were always associated with wisdom and healing, with the trees of life and knowledge being customarily identified with serpents. Indeed, the insignia of many of today's medical associations is precisely this image of a serpent coiled around the plant of birth, a depiction shown in the reliefs of ancient Sumer to be Enki's own personal emblem. Interestingly, though, another common emblem for medical relief organizations depicts two coiled serpents, spiraling around the winged caduceus of Hermes the magician. In these instances, the true symbolism of the starfire ritual is conveyed, and the symbol can be traced back to the very origins of the alchemical mystery schools and Gnostic institutions. The records explain that the central staff and entwined serpents represent the spinal cord and the sensory nervous system. The two uppermost wings signify the brain's lateral ventricular structures. Between these wings, above the spinal column, is shown the small central node of the pineal gland. The combination of the central pineal and its lateral wings has long been referred to as the swan, and in Grail lore, as in some yogic circles, the swan is emblematic of the fully enlightened being. This is the ultimate realm of consciousness achieved by the medieval knights of the swan, as epitomized by such chivalric figures as Perceval and Lohengrin. The pineal is a very small gland, shaped like a pine cone. It is centrally situated within the brain, although outside the ventricles, and not forming a part of the brain matter as such. About the size of a grain of corn, the gland was thought by the 17th century French optical scientist, René Descartes, to be the seat of the soul, the point at which the mind and body are conjoined. The ancient Greeks considered likewise, and, in the 4th century BC, Herophilus described the pineal as an organ which regulated the flow of thought. In the days of ancient Sumer, the priests of Anu, the father of Enlil and Enki, perfected and elaborated a ramifying medical science of living substances, with menstrual starfire being an essential source component. In the first instance, this was pure Anunnaki lunar essence called gold of the gods, and it was fed to the kings and queens of the dragon succession. Later, however, in Egypt and Mediterranean, menstrual extracts were ritually collected from sacred virgin priestesses who were venerated as the scarlet women. Indeed, the very word ritual stems from this practice, and from the word ritu, the redness, which defined the sacred ceremony. Hormonal supplements are, of course, still used by today's organotherapy establishment, but their inherent secretions, such as melatonin and serotonin, are obtained from the desiccated glands of dead animals, and they lack the truly important elements which exist only in live human glandular manufacture. In the fire symbolism of ancient alchemy, the color red is synonymous with the metal gold. In some traditions, including the Indian tantras, red is also identified with black. Hence, the goddess Kali is said to be both red and black. The original heritage of Kali was, however, Sumerian, and she was said to be Kalamath, the sister of Cain's wife Lulua. Kali was a primary princess of the Dragon House, and from her starfire association she became the goddess of time, seasons, periods, and cycles. In the early days, therefore, the metals of the alchemists were not common metals, but living essences, and the ancient mysteries were of a physical, not a metaphysical, nature. Indeed, the very word secret has its origin in the hidden knowledge of glandular secretions. Truth was the redo, from which stems not only ritual, but also the words rite, root, and red. The redo, it was said, reveals itself as physical matter in the form of the purest and most noble of all metals, gold, which was deemed to represent an ultimate truth. Just as the word secret has its origin in the translation of an ancient word, so too do other related words have their similar bases. In ancient Egypt, the word amen was used to signify something hidden or concealed. The word occult meant very much the same, hidden from view, and yet today we use amen to conclude prayers and hymns, while something occult is deemed sinister. In real terms, however, they both relate to the word secret, and all three words were, at one time or another, connected with the mystic science of endocrinal secretions. Since Kali was associated with black, the English word coal, denoting that which is black, stems also from her name via the intermediate word coal. In the Hebrew tradition, Bath Coal, a Kali counterpart, was called the daughter of the voice, and the voice was said to originate during a female's puberty. Hence, the womb was associated with the enigmatic voice, and starfire was said to be the oracular word of the womb. The womb was, therefore, the utterer, or the uterus. The scarlet women were so called because of their being a direct source of the priestly starfire. They were known in Greek as the hierodule, sacred women, a word later transformed, via medieval French into English, to harlot. In the early Germanic tongue they were known as horess, which was later anglicized to horse. However, the word originally meant, quite simply, beloved ones. As explained in good etymological dictionaries, these words were descriptions of high veneration and were never interchangeable with such definitions as prostitute or adulteress. Their now common association was, in fact, a wholly contrived strategy of the medieval Roman Church in its bid to denigrate the noble status of the sacred priestess. The withdrawal of knowledge of the genuine starfire tradition from the public domain occurred when the science of the early adepts and later Gnostics was stifled by the forgers of historic Christianity. A certain amount of the original gnosis, knowledge, is preserved in Talmudic and rabbinical lore, but, in general terms, the mainstream Jews and Christians did all in their power to distort and destroy all traces of the ancient art. In addition to being the gold of the gods, the Anunnaki menstruum was also called the vehicle of light, being the ultimate source of manifestation, and, in this regard, it was directly equated with the mystical waters of creation, the flow of eternal wisdom. It was for this reason that the Rosy Crucis, cup of the waters, became the mark of Cain and the subsequent emblem of the kingly succession. It was said that the light remained quite dormant in a spiritually unawakened person, but that it could be awakened and motivated by the spiritual energy of self-will and by constant self-inquiry. This is not an obvious mental process, but a truly thought-free consciousness, a formless plane of pure being or knowingness. It was this very concept of self-completeness which posed the ultimate problem for Enlil Jehovah. In contrast, his brother Enki knew that humans who partook of the tree of knowledge, the Anunnaki wisdom, and of the plant of birth, the Anunnaki starfire, could themselves become almost like gods. Even Jehovah was said to have recognized this, and Genesis states that when Adam had taken the fruit of the tree, Jehovah said, "Behold, the man is become as one of us." Enki, the wise guardian of the tree of knowledge, also had another name in the Hebrew tradition, wherein he was called Samael, Samael, because he was the designated lord of Sama in northern Mesopotamia. The teachings of the mystery schools were very specific about the trees of life and knowledge, and they emulated the wisdom of Enki himself, maintaining, "Nothing is obtained simply by wanting, and nothing is achieved by relinquishing responsibility to a higher authority. Belief is the act of believing, For to be live is to believe, and will is the ultimate medium of the self. The Sumerian annals relate that Cain's son, King Adonah, partook of the plant of birth in order to father his own son and heir, King Bali, while the plant of birth was itself associated with individual longevity and the office of kingship. It was, in practice, related to star fire and to pineal gland activity, and partaking from the plant of birth was the ritual of ingesting the star fire, the Anunnaki female essence, which they called the nectar of supreme excellence. In this regard, the Anunnaki flower, the flower or lily, was held to be the cupbearer, the transmitter of the rich food of the matrix. In this capacity, she was called the Rose of Sharon, Sha'arayon. This derives from the word Sha, meaning orbit, along with the words Ra and On, relating to the ultimate temple of light. Hence, she was the Rose of the Orbit of Light. The significance of this highly venerated station is actually made apparent in the Bible's esoteric Song of Solomon, wherein the Messianic Bride proclaims, "I am the Rose of Sharon and the Lily of the Valleys." A starfire recipient king was considered to have become qualified for kingship when he reached a predestined state of enlightened consciousness, a state when his aptitudes for wisdom and leadership had been enhanced to a realm of kingship called the Makhu. It was from this Mesopotamian word that the Hebrews derived their words Malchus, king, and Makhut, kingdom. Only in very recent times have medical scientists identified the hormonal secretion of the pineal gland. It was finally isolated in 1968 and the essence was called melatonin, which means night worker, from the Greek melos, meaning black, and tozos, meaning labor. Those with a high melatonin output react strongly against sunlight, which affects their mental capability. They are essentially night operatives and melatonin is called the hormone of darkness, being produced only at night or out of sunlight. Exposure to an excess of sunlight actually makes the pineal gland smaller and lessens spiritual awareness, whereas darkness and high pineal activity enhance the keen intuitive knowledge of the subtle mind, while reducing the stress factor. Melatonin enhances and boosts the body's immune system, and those with high pineal secretion are less likely to develop cancerous diseases. High melatonin production heightens energy, stamina and physical tolerance levels. It is also directly related to sleep patterns, keeping the body temperately regulated with properties that operate through the cardiovascular system. Melatonin is, in fact, the body's most potent and effective antioxidant and it has positive mental and physical anti-aging properties. This valuable hormone is manufactured by the pineal gland through activating a chemical messenger called serotonin, which transmits nerve impulses across chromosome pairs at a point called meiosis. This is the moment when the cell nuclei are divided and the chromosomes are halved, to eventually be combined with other half-sets upon fertilization. Pine resin was long identified with pineal secretion and was used to make frankincense, the incense of priesthood. Gold, on the other hand, was a traditional symbol of kingship. Hence, gold and frankincense were the traditional substances of the priest-kings of the Messianic line, along with myrrh, a gum resin used as a medical sedative, which was symbolic of death. In the ancient world, higher knowledge was identified as death, from which comes the word death. Indeed, the New Testament describes that these three substances, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, were presented to Jesus by the Magi, thereby identifying him, beyond doubt, as a hereditary priest-king of the dragon succession. Yogic teachers suggest that the pineal gland, which they call the third eye, or the eye of wisdom, is significant in the process of becoming aware, for it is the ultimate source of the light. Illuminists and other Rosicrucian adepts have long referred to the pineal as the secret eye, an ancient word for eye. Interestingly, Inki-Samael was the designated lord of the sacred eye. It is said that a truly spiritual person can automatically perceive with the third eye, the subtle eye of insight, rather than be duped by mundane eyes which reveal only physical presences. Such presences are defined by their place within arbitrary time, but to pineal graduates there is no time to calculate for they live in a dimension where time and space are of little consequence. And so the Cainite kings of Mesopotamia, the first dragon lords of the Messianic bloodline, while already being of high Anunnaki substance, were fed with Anunnaki star fire to increase their perception, awareness, and intuition. Consequently, they became masters of knowingness, almost like gods themselves. At the same time, their stamina levels and immune systems were dramatically strengthened so that the anti-aging properties of the regularly ingested hormonal secretions facilitated extraordinary lifespans. In addition to the starfire ritual, the bloodline kings were also said to have been nourished with the milk of the goddess, and it would appear that this contained an enzyme that was itself conducive to active longevity. Today's genetic researchers call this enzyme telomerase. As recently reported in the Science Journal, Vol. 279-16 January 1998, corporate studies and those of the University of Texas Southwestern Medical Center have determined that telomerase has unique anti-aging properties. Healthy body cells are programmed to divide many times during a lifetime, but this process of division and replication is finite, so that a non-dividing state is ultimately achieved. This is a crucial factor of aging. The division potential is controlled by caps at the end of DNA strands, rather like the plastic tips on shoelaces. These caps are the telomeres and, as each cell divides, a piece of telomere is lost. The dividing process ceases when the telomeres have shortened to an optimum and critical length, subsequent to which there is no further cell replication and all that follows is deterioration. Laboratory experiments with tissue samples have now shown that an application of the genetic enzyme telomerase can prevent telomere shortening upon cell division and replication. Hence, body cells can continue to divide way beyond their naturally restricted programming, just as do cancer cells which achieve immortality through being rich in telomerase. Telomerase is not usually expressed in normal body tissue but, apart from being present in malignant tumors, it is also apparent in reproductive cells. It seems, therefore, that within our DNA structure is the genetic ability to produce this anti-aging enzyme, but that the potential has somehow been switched off and lies dormant. It probably exists within those aspects of our DNA which scientists currently refer to as junk. In the canonical Bible, we are told that, during the lifetimes of Noah and his sons, Jehovah issued the edict which forbade the ingesting of blood, at least this was the time frame applied to the edict by the Old Testament compilers in the 6th century BC. It is unlikely, however, that this was the correct time frame, for at that stage Enlil Jehovah would have had no such final authority over Anu, Inki, and the Grand Assembly of the Anunnaki. Nevertheless, it is apparent that, from that time, the given ages of the patriarchal strain begin to diminish quite considerably, so that from the days of Abraham and Isaac we are presented, in the main, with rather more normal lifespans. In contrast, however, the lifespans of the Sumerian kings in descent from Cain and Adonai continued at a generally high level. What we do know beyond doubt is that, whatever the realities of the edict and its chronology, a major change in the starfire practice became necessary in about 1960 BC. This was when the Bible tells us that Abraham and his family moved northward from Ur of the Chaldees, the capital of Sumer, to Haran in the kingdom of Mari, before turning westward into Canaan. Contemporary historical texts record that Ur was sacked by the king of nearby Elam soon after 2000 BC and, although the city was rebuilt, the new power center was established at Haran. But Haran was not just the name of a flourishing city, it was the name of Abraham's brother, the father of Lot. Existing documents, discovered in 1934, also reveal that other cities in Mesopotamia were similarly named in accordance with Abraham's forebears, cities such as Terah, Abraham's father, Nahor, Terah's father, Serug, Nahor's father, and Peleg, Serug's grandfather. Quite apparently, in line with all the Sumerian evidence which supports the kingly line from Cain, these lately discovered reports confirm that the immediate family of Abraham, in the succession after Noah, were also great commissioners of the region in general. Clearly, the patriarchs represented no ordinary family, but constituted a very powerful dynasty. But why would such a long-standing heritage of prominence and renown come to an abrupt end and force Abraham out of Mesopotamia into Canaan? The answer is to be found in clay tablets which can be dated to about 1960 BC. They detail that, at that time, everything changed in the hitherto sacred land of Sumer when invaders came in from all sides. They were Akkadians from the north, Amorites from Syria and Elamites from Persia. The text continues. When they overthrew, when order they destroyed. Then like a deluge all things together consumed. Whereunto, O Sumer? Did they change thee? The sacred dynasty from the temple they exiled. It was at this stage of Sumerian history that the empire fell and Abraham was forced to flee northward from the city of Ur. But what had happened to the Anunnaki, the grand assembly of gods who had established everything? Once more, the text continues. Ur is destroyed, bitter is its lament. The country's blood now fills its holes like hot bronze in a mold. Bodies dissolve like fat in the sun. Our temple is destroyed. Smoke lies on our cities like a shroud. The gods have abandoned us like migrating birds. In historical terms, this total collapse of the Sumerian Empire follows the founding of Babylon by King Urbaba in about 2000 BC. Indeed, the story of the Tower of Babel, and the resultant wrath of Jehovah precisely fits the time frame of the Sumerians' own abandonment by the Anunnaki. The story in Genesis relates that the people, who were hitherto said by Jehovah to be very good, were severely punished because of a strange transgression which had not previously been ruled upon. The apparent transgression was that they all spoke the same language, and the unique language which they all spoke was, of course, Sumerian, the first comprehensively written language on earth. For a reason which is not made clear in the Bible, the Genesis text explains that Jehovah was not happy about the Tower of Babel, and so he did come down, and did confound the language of all the earth. The Sumerian historical documents tell much the same story, except that the confounding of language is far better explained by the hordes of foreign invaders who came into the region. It transpires that this invasion was the direct result of friction among the Anunnaki, for at Anu's retirement from the Grand Assembly his elder son-in-law Jehovah assumed the presidency. He proclaimed that he was master of all the earth, although his brother Enki Samael could retain sovereignty of the seas. Enki was not at all happy about his brother's claim because, although Enlil was the elder of the two, his mother, Ki, was their father Anu's junior sister, whereas Enki's mother, Untu, was the senior sister. True kingship, claimed Enki, progressed as a matrilinear institution through the female line, and by this right of descent Enki maintained that he was the firstborn of the royal succession. I am Enki, he stated, the great brother of the gods. I am he who has been born as the first son of the divine Anu. As a result, the people of Babylon announced their allegiance to Enki and his son Marduk, which proved unacceptable to Enlil Jehovah. Having lost his popularity, he opened the gates of Sumer to let in invaders from the surrounding nations. The scribes recorded that he brought about the great and terrible storm which caused the annihilation of all the Sumerian culture, so that their language was no longer predominant and there was a great confusion of tongues. All the work which had been accomplished in building up a unique civilization over thousands of years was destroyed in one fell swoop by Enlil Jehovah simply because he would not share authority with his brother Enki. The records confirm that, at that moment in Sumerian history, the Grand Assembly of the Anunnaki simply vacated their seats and departed like migrating birds. For all that had occurred to the point of Anunnaki departure, an urgent and significant change in kingly procedure was then necessary because the Anunnaki star fire was no longer available. A substitute had to be found and, as previously mentioned, the priestly scarlet women had been purpose-bred for this. However, it was clear that, however carefully mated, their genetic essence would weaken through the generations having no further Anunnaki input. In the event, the creation of a more permanent and versatile substitute for the starfire was not a problem, for this was the province of a group of previously trained metallurgists whom Enki had called the master craftsmen. The first of these great metallurgists to be trained had been Tubal Cain the Vulcan, a sixth generation descendant of Cain, who is remembered today in modern Freemasonry. In consideration of the Bible's New Testament, it is of particular interest to note that Jesus's father, Joseph, was himself recorded in the early Gospels as being a master craftsman. In modern English language Bibles, he is described as a carpenter, but this is a blatant mistranslation. The word carpenter was wrongly derived from the Greek hotekton, a derivative of the Semitic nagar, which actually defined a master of the craft, or master craftsman. Joseph was, therefore, not a woodworker, but a learned alchemical metallurgist in the manner of his ancestral forebears. In the Old Testament book of Exodus, at the time of Moses, we are introduced to a certain Bezalel, the son of Uri ben Hur, who is said to have been filled with the spirit of the Elohim, the Anunnaki, in wisdom, understanding, and knowledge. We learn, furthermore, that Bezalel was a skilled goldsmith and master craftsman who was placed in overall charge of building the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant. In detailing how Bezalel should manufacture various crowns, rings, bowls and a candlestick, all of pure gold, the Bible text adds to the list something called the showbread of the covenant and, without further explanation, the deed is seen to be done. Although the word covenant has come to be identified with contractual agreements, it originally meant to eat bread with, and it is pertinent to note that the Christian Lord's Prayer, which was itself transposed from an Egyptian equivalent, specifies, "Give us this day our daily bread." This is often taken to relate to sustenance in general terms, but in the original tradition the reference was more specifically directed to the enigmatic shoe bread, the golden bread of Bezalel. The book of Leviticus also refers to the shoe bread, stating, "And thou shalt take fine flour, and bake 12 cakes thereof. And thou shalt put pure frankincense upon each row." The use of the word flour in English translations is actually incorrect, and the word powder would be more accurate. The records of the mystery schools cite rather more precisely that showbread was made with the white powder of gold, which is especially significant because it is stated in Exodus that Moses took the golden calf which the Israelites had made, and burnt it in the fire, and ground it to a powder. In this instance, the correct word powder is used, but firing gold does not, of course, produce powder, it actually produces molten gold. So what was this magical white powder? Is there a way of using heat to transform metallic gold into a white powder which is ingestible and beneficial? Indeed there is, and it is here that the foremost alchemical principle of the master craftsman was applied. To make gold, you must take gold. Gold is the most noble of metals and was always representative of truth. Through the regular use of an Anunnaki star fire, the gold of the gods, the recipients had been moved into realms of heightened awareness and consciousness because of its inherent melatonin and serotonin. This was the realm of advanced enlightenment which was called the plane of Sharon, and the star fire gold was deemed to be the ultimate route to the light. Hence, the heavy, mundane person, lead, could be elevated to a heightened state of awareness, perceived as gold, and this was the root of all alchemical lore thereafter. The shoe bread, or as the Egyptians called it, skefa food, was a traditional entitlement of the Israelite and Egyptian messiahs, for the early pharaohs were themselves fully consecrated priest kings of the Grail bloodline, having descended through King Nimrod in the Cainite succession. In ancient Egypt, the skefa food was always depicted as a conical cake. This metallic bread was used to feed the light body, as against the physical body, and the light body, the ka, was deemed to be the consciousness. As far back as 2200 BC, the pharaohs were using this supplement to enhance their pituitary and pineal activity, thereby heightening their perception, awareness, and intuition, but only the metallurgical adepts of the mystery schools, the master craftsmen of the Dragon Court, knew the secret of its manufacture. In the Egyptian Book of the Dead, the oldest complete book in the world, the pharaoh in search of ultimate food of enlightenment asks, at every stage of his journey, the single overriding question, what is it? A question which in the Hebrew language, as explained in the Antiquities of the Jews, was asked by the single word, manna. When the Ark of the Covenant was completed, Aaron was said to have placed an omer of manna into the ark. This sacred manna was commonly associated with a mystical form of bread, the shoe bread or, as it was called in Tubal Cain's Mesopotamia, the Shemen Ene. At this point, we come to a particularly important definition of the shoe bread for, according to the master craftsman, this conically shaped, or shem-shaped, food was made of high-ward firestone. In the New Testament book of the Revelation it is related, "To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone." Before investigating the precise nature of the white stone of the Shemen Na, the bread made from the white powder of alchemical gold, it is worth considering the famous statue of priest King Melchizedek at Chartres Cathedral in France. The statue portrays Melchizedek with a cup containing a stone in representation of the bread and wine which he apparently offered to Abraham, according to the book of Genesis. The wine, as we know, was emblematic of the sacred star fire, just as communion wine represents the messianic blood today, but the true importance of the imagery is that the bread/stone is held within the cup, thereby signifying that star fire was replaced by a substitute nourishment at the very time of Melchizedek and Abraham. This substitute was made from Shemen Na, the white powder of gold, which the Mesopotamians called high-ward firestone. The object of the substitute was very straightforward. Instead of feeding the recipient with a direct hormonal supplement, the powder had its effect on the endocrinal system, particularly on the pineal gland, thereby causing the recipient to manufacture his own super high levels of hormones such as melatonin. In the famous Middle Age Grail romance of Partival, by Wolfram von Eschenbach, it is said of the Temple Knights of Grail Castle, "They live by virtue of a stone most pure. If you do not know its name, now learn, it is called Lapis Exilis. By the power of the stone the phoenix is burned to ashes. But the ashes speedily restore it to life. The phoenix thus molts, and thereupon gives out a bright light, so that it is as beautiful as before." Many have wondered about the name Lapis Exilis because it appears to be a play on words, combining two elements. Firstly, it is Lapis Exilis, meaning stone from the heavens. Secondly, it is Lapis Elixir, the philosopher's stone by which base elements are transformed to higher states of being. Either way, or both, it relates directly to the high-ward firestone, the Shemen Na of the exotic starfire substitute. The key to the Partival allegory lies in the description that the phoenix is burned to ashes, but from those very ashes comes the great enlightenment. So, what exactly is a phoenix? It is a mythical bird, one might answer, but this would be quite wrong. The word phoenix is far older than the Bennu bird mythology and it is, in fact, ancient Greco-Phoenician. Phoenix means crimson or red gold. An old Alexandrian alchemical text makes particular mention of the weight of the firestone, which it calls the stone of paradise. It states that, when placed in the scales, the stone can outweigh its quantity of gold, but when it is transposed to dust, even a feather will tip the scales against it. In terms of a mathematical formula, this was written as 0 equals plus 1 plus minus 1. This appears to be a very straightforward sum at first glance, because plus 1 plus minus 1 does indeed equal 0. But when applied to physical matter, it is actually an impossibility because it relies upon using a positive and an equivalent negative to produce nothing. The moment one has a positive piece of something, it is not possible to add an equivalent negative of that something to produce nothing. At best, one could move the positive something out of immediate sight, but it would still exist and would, therefore, not be nothing. The only way to turn something into nothing as far as the material field is concerned is to translate the something into another dimension so that it physically disappears from the mundane environment. If that process is achieved, then the proof of achievement would lie in the fact that its weight also disappears. What then is it that can outweigh itself, but can also underweight itself and become nothing? What then is it that can be gold, but can be fired and transposed to dust? It is the phoenix, the red gold that will fire to ashes, but will then be restored to enlightenment. It is the golden calf that Moses burned to a powder. It is the high-ward firestone of the Shemen Na, and the Sumerian records indicate that this was not made of stone at all, but of shining metal. In the alchemical tradition, the philosopher's stone is said to be that which translates base elements into gold. This is deemed to be the case in both the metallurgical sense and in the spiritual sense of higher enlightenment. In the physical sense, however, we must return to the oldest of all alchemical rules of the earliest mystery school, and that is: to make gold, you must take gold. Hence, it is determined that there are two distinctly separate forms of physical gold. The straightforward metal as we know it and a much higher state of gold, that is gold in a different dimension of perceived matter. This is the white powder of gold, the hidden manna, whose secret manufacture was known only to the master craftsman. So, what precisely is the highward state which converts gold into a sweet-tasting impalpable white powder? It is that which modern science now calls the high-spin state. A normal atom has around it a screening potential, a positive screening produced by the nucleus. The majority of electrons going round the nucleus are within this screening potential, except for the very outer electrons. However, the nucleus goes to the high-spin state when the positive screening potential expands to bring all of the electrons under the control of the nucleus. Electrons normally travel around the nucleus in pairs, a forward-spin electron and a reverse-spin electron, but when these come under the influence of a high-spin nucleus, all the forward-spin electrons become correlated with the reverse-spin electrons. When perfectly correlated, the electrons turn to pure white light, and it is quite impossible for the individual atoms in the high-spin substance to link together. Hence, they cannot reform as metal, and the whole remains simply an impalpable, monatomic white powder. A recently conducted experiment in the USA made apparent the effect of the mystical white light in open-air conditions, without the controls of vacuums and inert gases necessary for contained results. In this test, the blaze was equivalent to many tens of thousands of flash bulbs. It was, in effect, an explosion, but there was absolutely no blast, and an unsupported pencil, which had been stood on end within the explosion, was left standing upright and unharmed afterwards. This is wholly reminiscent of the story of Moses and the burning bush as related in Exodus. And he looked, and, behold, the bush burned without fire, and the bush was not consumed. The truly unusual thing about this white powder is that, through various applied procedures, its weight will rise and fall to hundreds of percent above its optimum weight, down to less than absolutely nothing. Moreover, its optimum weight is actually 56% of the metal weight from which it was transmuted. So, where does the other 44% go? It becomes nothing but pure white light and translates to another dimension beyond the physical plane. Another feature of the Shemin Na is that even its 56% substance, that is the remaining sample excluding the 44% light content, can be made to disappear completely from sight, moving itself into another dimension of perceived matter, and when this happens, its weight similarly disappears. By virtue of such testing, it has been discovered that not only is the powder of the high-ward firestone capable of raising human consciousness, but it is also a monatomic superconductor with no gravitational attraction. One of the great researchers into gravity from the 1960s has been the Russian physicist Andrei Sakharov, and the mathematics for Sakharov's theory, based on gravity as a zero point, were published by Hal Puthoff of the Institute of Advanced Studies in 1989, Physical Review A, Volume 39, Number 5, March 1. With regard to the monatomic white powder, Puthoff has made the point that because gravity determines space-time, then the powder is capable of bending space-time. It is exotic matter, he explained, with a gravitational attraction of less than zero. Quite apart from gold, it is now known that the platinum group metals, iridium and rhodium, in the monatomic high-spin state, also have anti-aging properties, while ruthenium and platinum compounds interact with DNA and the cellular body. In the Scientific American Journal of May 1995, the effect of ruthenium was discussed in relation to human DNA, and it was pointed out that when single ruthenium atoms are placed at each end of double helix DNA, it becomes 10,000 times more conductive. Similarly, the Platinum Metals Review features regular articles concerning the use of platinum, iridium, and ruthenium in the treatment of cancers, which are caused through the abnormal and uncontrolled division of body cells. When a DNA state is altered, as in the case of a cancer, the application of a platinum compound will resonate with the deformed cell, causing the DNA to relax thoroughly and become corrected. Such treatment involves no amputation surgery, it does not destroy surrounding tissue with radiation, nor kill the immune system as does chemotherapy. It is a straightforward cure which actually corrects altered cells. It is of particular significance that, irrespective of all today's costly and extensive research, the secrets of the High Ward Firestone were known to our ancestors many thousands of years ago, although only just being rediscovered. To put things into perspective in this regard, it is important to recognize that just about everything we now know about the life and civilizations of the distant BC years has been learned since the late 1800s. Prior to that, the Old Testament was one of very few documents of record, but the Old Testament was never intended to be an accurate reporting of history, it was actually a book of scripture designed to underpin a growing religious movement. To some extent, just like the scriptures of other religions, the Hebrew writings were based upon mythological tradition, but since the inherent stories were never found until recently in any other documented form, the Old Testament has, for countless centuries, been treated as if it were an absolute factual truth. And so, the mythology became designated as history by governing and educational establishments, and it has been taught as such in schools and churches for the longest time. Now we have a vast amount of original literature, enabling us to be far better informed, for any number of explanatory documents have been unearthed, documents predating the original writing of Genesis by up to 2,000 years. One would expect such discoveries to be welcomed with enthusiasm, but this has not been the case. Instead, they have posed severe problems and are regarded not as beneficial revelations, but as threats. What do they threaten? They threaten to undermine the one-time mythology that has been erroneously dubbed as history. How does the establishment cope with this threat? It clings on tight to the contrived history, and declares that the first-hand documents of history are mythological. Between the 1850s and the 1930s, records which had been hidden for countless lifetimes beneath the windswept desert sands suddenly appeared, bearing the names of such well-known characters as Abraham, Esau, Israel, Heber, Nahor, Terah, and others from the Bible. These were written during the lifetimes of these men or soon after, whereas the books of the Old Testament were compiled over 1,000 years later. However, one by one, these documents have been classified as mythology. Why? Because they tell a very different story to that which is taught from the Bible. By the 1880s, the governing establishments of Christendom were dreading the very word archaeologist. As a result, archaeological digs were brought under strict control, with their funding and undertakings to be approved by newly designated authorities. One of these, the Egypt Exploration Fund, was established in Britain in 1891, and on the very first page of its memorandum and articles of association, it is stated that the fund's objective is to promote excavation work for the purpose of elucidating or illustrating the Old Testament narrative. In short, this meant that if something was found which could be used to support the scriptural teaching, then the public would be informed. Anything which did not support the church interpretation of the Bible was not destined to see the light in the public domain. It is now relevant to take a look at one of the monumental finds from that era, a discovery about which very little is known to people at large. In fact, it is probably the most important biblical discovery ever made, and it has stunning implications far beyond the discovery itself, for this is the ultimate story of the Phoenix and the Firestone. Within the book of Exodus, a significant biblical mountain is named. It sits in the extensive range of the Sinai Peninsula, an upturned triangular landmass which lies above the Red Sea between the gulfs of Suez and Aqaba. In the Old Testament, the mountain is firstly called Mount Horeb, then it is called Mount Sinai and is subsequently called Horeb again as the story progresses. The story is, of course, that of Moses and the Israelite exodus from Egypt. This was the mountain upon which, according to Exodus, Moses saw the burning bush, the mountain where he talked with Jehovah and the place where he received the Ten Commandments and the Tables of Testimony. Something which should be recognized at this stage is that, at the time of Moses, About 1350 BC, there was no mountain called Mount Sinai. There was no mountain by that name even in the days of Jesus, nor even for another 300 years. It should also be remembered that the Old Testament, which is familiar to us today, stems from a 10th century Hebrew text and is, therefore, 600 years younger even than the canonical New Testament compiled in the 4th century. The mountain now generally known as Mount Sinai sits in the south of the peninsula, quite near to the bottom point of the upturned triangle, and it was given its name in the 4th century by a mission of Greek Christian monks 1,700 years after the time of Moses. It is now sometimes called Gebel Musa, or Mount of Moses, and there is still a Christian retreat there called St. Catherine's Monastery. However, this is not the Sinai Mountain which the Bible calls Mount Horeb. The book of Exodus goes into some detail to explain the route taken by Moses and the Israelites from the Egyptian Nile Delta land of Goshen, down across the wilderness regions of Shur and Paran in northern Sinai, to the land of Midian, which is to the north of present-day Jordan. From this route it becomes very easy to identify the location of Mount Horeb, which sits a good deal north of Gebel Musa. The word Horeb simply means desert, and the great desert mountain which soars to over 2,600 feet within a high stone plateau above the plain of Paran is today called Sarabat el-Kadhim, the prominence of the Kadhim. In the late 1890s, the British Egyptologist Sir William Flinders Petrie, a professor at the University College, London, applied to the Egypt Exploration Fund to take an expedition into Sinai. By January 1904, his team had departed and in the March of that year they took their expedition to the heights of Mount Sarabat. In the following year Petrie published the detailed results of his findings, but added to his report the fact that, to his dismay, this information would not be made available to the Egypt Exploration Fund subscribers, who would receive only maps and a general outline. Furthermore, Petrie explained that, from the time of that Sinai expedition, even though he had taken previously funded teams into Egypt, his sponsorship by the fund was terminated, ostensibly because he had broken the binding rule of the articles by divulging something which was contrary to Bible teaching. He had, in fact, discovered the great secret of the sacred mountain of Moses, a secret which not only made sense of the Exodus portrayals, but which blew the lid totally from their common scriptural interpretation. What the Bible does not make clear is that Sinai was not a foreign land to the Egyptians. It was actually regarded as a part of Egypt and came under pharaonic control. So Moses and the Israelites had not left Egypt once they were east of the Nile Delta, they were still in Egypt, having the whole Sinai Peninsula to cross before they entered the Palestinian land of Canaan. During the time of Moses, Sinai came under the control of two Egyptian officials, the royal chancellor and the royal messenger. This was the era of Egypt's 18th dynasty, the dynasty of the Thutmosis and Amenhotep pharaohs, along with Akhenaten and Tutankhamun. The royal messenger of those times was an official called Nebi. He was also the mayor and troop commander of Zeru in the Egyptian delta region of Goshen, where the Israelites had lived before the Exodus. The position of royal chancellor was hereditary in the Hyksos family of Panahaz, and Panazi of this family was the official governor of Sinai. We know him better from the Bible as Phinehas. He became one of the first priests of the new Mosaic structure, but had previously been the chief priest at Pharaoh Akhenaten's temple at Amarna. In order to understand the root significance of Petrie's discovery, it is worth making a necessary distinction between the Israelites and the Hebrews of the Mosaic era. At that time, they were not one and the same as Bible teaching seems to indicate. The Hebrews were the family and descendants of Abraham, whose place of residence was, in the main, Canaan, Palestine. The Israelites, on the other hand, were the family and descendants of one of Abraham's grandsons, the man called Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel. It was his family alone who had moved into Egypt, and it was their descendants who eventually returned with Moses to be reunited, after countless generations, with their fellow Hebrews. The difference between the strains was, of course, that the Israelites had long been subjected to the laws and religions of Egypt, and they knew very little about the customs of their cousins hundreds of miles away in Canaan. Through more than 400 years they had been in an environment which supported a whole pantheon of gods and, although they had developed a one-god concept within their own fraternity, that god was not the Jehovah of the Canaanite Hebrews. Their god was a faceless entity whom they called, quite simply, the Lord. In the Israelite tongue, he was called the Adon. This is one of the reasons why the names Lord and Jehovah were separately identified in early texts, even though they were brought under the wrap of the single God in later times to suit the emergent Jewish and Christian faiths. To the Egyptians, the name of this Lord, Adon, was quite similar, and they called him Aten, from which derived the name of Pharaoh Akhenaten, servant of Aten. So, when Moses and the Israelites made their exodus into Sinai, they arrived not as worshippers of Jehovah, but of Aten, and it was for this very reason that they were presented with new laws and ordinances to bring them into line with the Hebrew culture of their prospective new homeland. When Moses and the Israelites left the Egyptian Delta, their obvious route to Canaan would have been directly across the wilderness of northern Sinai, but, instead, they pushed southward into the difficult high country to spend time at the Horeb mountain of Serebit. This was the anomaly which had long puzzled Petrie and his team. Mount Serebit. What then did the Petrie expedition discover high on the Bible's holy mountain? Well, to begin, they found nothing very much, but on a wide plateau near the summit there were distinct signs of ancient habitation. Pillars and standing stones could be seen protruding above the ground rubble which had been deposited by wind and landslides over some 3,000 years. Subsequent to clearing this rubble, however, the truth of the Bible story emerged and Petrie wrote, "There is no other such monument which makes us regret that it is not in better preservation. The whole of it was buried, and no one had any knowledge of it until we cleared the site." What they found was an enormous Egyptian temple complex. Set within an enclosure wall was an outer temple built over an expanse of 230 feet, c. 70 meters, and this extended outwards from an inner temple cut within a great cave in the mountainside. From the various cartouches, carvings, and inscriptions it emerged that the temple had been in use from as far back as the time of Pharaoh Sneferu, who reigned about 2600 BC and whose immediate successors are reckoned to have built the pyramids of Gizeh. The above-ground part of the temple was constructed from sandstone quarried from the mountain cave, and it contained a series of adjoined halls, shrines, courts, cubicles and chambers. Of these, the key features unearthed were the main sanctuary, the Shrine of Kings, the portico court, and the hall of the goddess Hathor, to whom the whole complex was dedicated. All around were pillars and stelae denoting the Egyptian kings through the ages, with certain pharaohs such as Thutmosis III, founder of the Rosicrucian movement in Egypt, depicted many times on standing stones and wall reliefs. The adjoining cave of Hathor was carved into the natural rock, with flat inner walls that had been carefully smoothed. In the center from about 1820 BC, stood a large upright pillar of Pharaoh Amenemhet III, the son-in-law of Esau. Also portrayed were his senior chamberlain and his seal-bearer. Deep within the cave Petrie found a limestone stela of Pharaoh Ramesses I, a slab upon which Ramesses, who is traditionally reckoned by Egyptologists to have been an opposer of the Aten cult, surprisingly described himself as the ruler of all that Aten embraces. Also found was an Amarna statue head of Akhenaten's mother, Queen Ti of Egypt, with her cartouche set in the crown. In the courts and halls of the outer temple there were numerous stone-carved rectangular tanks and circular basins, along with a variety of curiously shaped bench tables with recessed fronts and split-level surfaces. There were also round tables, trays, and saucers, together with alabaster vases and containers, many of which were shaped like lotus flowers. In addition, the rooms housed a good collection of glazed plagues, cartouches, scarabs and sacred ornaments, designed with spirals, diagonal squares and basketwork. There were magical wands of an unidentified hard material, while in the portico were two conical stones of about 6 inches and 9 inches in height, respectively. The explorers were baffled enough by these, but they were further confounded by the discovery of a metallurgist's crucible. Ever since this discovery, Egyptologists have argued as to why a crucible would have been necessary in a temple, while at the same time debating a mysterious substance called MFKZT, which seemed to be related to the conical stones and which has numerous mentions in wall and stele inscriptions. Some have suggested that MFKZT might have been copper, many have preferred the idea of turquoise and others have supposed it was perhaps malachite, but they are all unsubstantiated guesses and there are no traces of any of these materials at the site. Sinai is noted for its turquoise mines, but if turquoise mining had been a primary function of the temple masters over so many centuries, then one would expect to find turquoise stones in abundance within the tombs of Egypt. However, such is not the case, hardly any have been found. Other causes of wonderment have been the innumerable inscribed references to bread, along with the prominent hieroglyph for light, found in the shrine of the kings. But the discovery which caused the most bewilderment was the unearthing of something which was identified as the enigmatic MFKZT to which the bread symbolism appeared to be related. Laying some inches deep beneath heavy flagstones in a storeroom was a considerable supply of the finest pure white, unadulterated powder. At the time, some suggested that the powder could be a remnant of copper smelting but, as was quickly pointed out, smelting does not produce white powder, it leaves a dense black slag. Moreover, there is no supply of copper or within miles of the temple and the old smelting works are, in any event, apparent in the distant valleys. Others guessed that the powder was ash from the burning of plants to produce alkali, but there was no trace whatever of any plant residue. For want of any other explanation, it was determined that the white powder and the conical stones were probably associated with some form of sacrificial rite, but again it was pointed out that this was an Egyptian temple and animal sacrifice was not an Egyptian practice. Moreover, despite sieving and winnowing, there were no remnants whatever of bones or any other foreign matter to be found within the MFKZT, which appeared for all the world like a hoard of sacred talcum powder. Some of the mysterious powder was taken back to Britain for analysis and examination, but no results were ever published. The rest was left open to the elements after 3,000 years to become a victim of the desert winds. What has become apparent, however, is that this powder was seemingly identical to the ancient Mesopotamian firestone or Shemen Na, the substance that was made into bread cakes and used to feed the light bodies of the Babylonian kings and the pharaohs of Egypt. This, of course, explains the temple inscriptions denoting the importance of bread and light, while the white powder, the Shemen Na, has been identified with the sacred manna that Aaron placed in the Ark of the Covenant. The Book of Exodus relates that the master craftsman who made the original shoe bread for Moses in Sinai was Bezalel, but Bezalel was not a baker, he was a noted goldsmith, the very man who made the golden accoutrements for the tabernacle and the ark itself. This conforms precisely with the function of the priestly master craftsman in Mesopotamia, the Vulcans and metallurgists of Tubal-Cain who manufactured the valuable Shemen Na from pure gold. As for the crucible, the conical stones and the great array of tanks, tables, and equipment which made the Sinai temple appear more like a gigantic laboratory than a church, it emerges that this is precisely what it was. What Petrie had actually found was the alchemical workshop of Akhenaten and of the numerous dynasties of pharaohs before him, a temple laboratory where the furnace would have roared and smoked in the production of the sacred firestone of the high-spin Shemen Na. Quite suddenly, the words of Exodus begin to make sense as we read them again with a wholly new insight. And Mount Sinai was altogether on a smoke. And the smoke thereof ascended as the smoke of a furnace. And the whole mount quaked greatly. In Exodus we read that Moses took the golden calf, which the Israelites had made, and burned it in the fire, and ground it to a powder. This is precisely the process of a Shemen Na furnace and it is evident that the Egyptian priests of the goddess Hathor had been working their fire for countless generations before the priests of Aten became involved in the time of Moses. It was, in fact, Pharaoh Thutmosis III who had reorganized the ancient mystery schools of Thoth and founded the royal school of the master craftsmen at Karnak. They were called the Great White Brotherhood because of their preoccupation with a mysterious white powder. A branch of this fraternity became especially concerned with medicines and healing, to become known as the Egyptian Therapeutate. Then, in much later times, the activities of the Therapeutate were extended into Palestine, especially into the Judah settlement of Qumran, where they flourished as the Essenes. But, what was so special about the goddess Hathor that she was the chosen deity of the Sinai priests? Hathor was a paramount nursing goddess and, as the daughter of Ra, she was said to have given birth to the sun. She was the originally defined queen of the west and mistress of the netherworld, to where she was said to carry those who knew the right spells. She was the revered goddess of love, tombs, and song, and it was from the milk of Hathor that the pharaohs were said to gain their divinity, becoming gods in their own right. On one of the rock tablets near to the Mount Sarabit cave entrance is a representation of Thutmose IV in the presence of Hathor. Before him are two offering stands topped with lotus flowers, and behind him is a man bearing a conical cake identified as white bread. Another relief details the mason Ankib offering two conical bread cakes of Shemen Na to the king, and there are similar portrayals elsewhere in the temple complex. One of the most significant perhaps is a depiction of Hathor and Pharaoh Amenhotep III. The goddess holds a necklace in one hand, while offering the emblem of life and dominion to the pharaoh with the other. Behind her is the treasurer Sobekhotep, who holds in readiness a conical cake of white bread. Most importantly in this portrayal, however, is the fact that treasurer Sobekhotep is described as the overseer of the secrets of the House of Gold, who brought the noble and precious stone to His Majesty. Recent experiments with this amazing white powder of gold have proven that, under certain conditions, the substance can weigh less than nothing and can be made to disappear into an unknown dimension. But, the most interesting quality of the powder is that it can ride upon the Earth's magnetic field so that, when in a zero-gravity state, it is capable of transposing its own weightlessness to its host, thereby facilitating levitational powers. This host might be a straightforward laboratory pen or container, but it could equally be an enormous block of stone as used in pyramid building. Indeed, pyramids are, as established by their very name, fire-begotten. In the secret repository of the king's chamber, within the Great Pyramid, the age-old tradition relates that the builders had placed instruments of iron, arms which rust not, glass which might be bended but not broken, and strange spells. But what did the first explorers find, having tunneled their way into the sealed chamber? The only furniture was a lidless, hollowed stone coffer, and it contained not a body, but a layer of a mysterious powdery substance. This has been superficially determined to be grains of feldspar and mica, which are both minerals of the aluminium silicate group. However, during the course of the recent white powder research, aluminium and silica were two of the constituent elements revealed by conventional analysis of a granular sample that was known to be a 100% platinum group compound. As revealed a few years ago by the pioneering U.S. researcher David Hudson, standard laboratory testing for elemental constituents is done by striking a sample with a DC arc for 15 seconds at a sun surface heat of 5500 degrees centigrade. But, with the monatomic white powder, a continuation of the burn time way beyond the normal testing procedure revealed the noble metal of which the substance truly consisted. It is because of the limitations placed on the conventional testing sequence that 5% by dry weight of our brain tissue is said to be carbon, whereas more rigorous analysis reveals it as the platinum group metals iridium and rhodium in the high spin state. The king's chamber was, therefore, apparently contrived as a superconductor, capable of transporting the pharaoh into another dimension of space-time, and it was here that his rite of passage was administered in accordance with the Book of the Dead. The key to this rite of passage is defined by a single conical inscription near the entrance to the chamber. This hieroglyphic symbol, the only verifiable hieroglyph on the whole of the Gizeh Plateau, and the very same as appeared many times at the Sinai Mountain Temple, reads quite simply, bread. The fact is that, although the historical aspects of the Old Testament are treated and taught from a Hebrew standpoint with an originally Mesopotamian base, there was a significant Egyptian impact on the culture which has been strategically ignored. This comes to light specifically from the time of the Sinai incident and proves to be the very reason why the all-important Book of Jasher was excluded from the canon. It was upon the mountain at Sinai that Jehovah first announced his presence to Moses. Being an Aten supporter, Moses asked this new Lord and Master who he was, and the reply was I am that I am, which in phonetic Hebrew became Yahweh, Jehovah. However, for the longest time afterwards, the Israelites were not allowed to utter the name Jehovah, except for the high priest who was allowed to whisper it in private once a year. The problem was that prayers were supposed to be said to this new Godhead, but how would he know they were to him if his name was not mentioned? The Israelite exiles from Egypt knew that Jehovah was not the same as Aten, their traditional Adon or Lord, and so they presumed he must be the equivalent of the great state god of Egypt, even if not one and the same. It was decided, therefore, to add the name of that state god to all prayers thereafter, and the name of that god was Amen. To this day, the name of Amen is still recited at the end of prayers. Even the well-known Christian Lord's Prayer, as given in the Gospel of Matthew, was transposed from an Egyptian original which began, Amen, Amen, who art in heaven. As for the famous Ten Commandments, said to have been conveyed to Moses by God upon the mountain, these two are of Egyptian origin, deriving directly from spell number 125 in the Egyptian Book of the Dead. They were not new codes of conduct invented for the Israelites, but were simply newly stated versions of the ritual confessions of the pharaohs. For example, the confession I have not killed was transposed to the decree thou shalt not kill, I have not stolen became thou shalt not steal, I have not told lies became thou shalt not bear false witness, and so on. Not only were the Ten Commandments drawn from Egyptian ritual, but so too were the Psalms, which are attributed to King David, reworked from Egyptian hymns. Even the Old Testament book of Proverbs, the so-called wise words of Solomon, was translated almost verbatim into Hebrew from the writings of an Egyptian sage called Amin Mope. These are now held at the British Museum, and verse after verse of the book of Proverbs can be attributed to this Egyptian original. It has now been discovered that even the writings of Amin Mope were extracted from a far older work called The Wisdom of Tohutep, which comes from more than 2,000 years before the time of Solomon. In addition to the Book of the Dead and the ancient Wisdom of Tohutep, various other Egyptian texts were used in compiling the Old Testament. These include the pyramid texts and the coffin texts, from which references to the Egyptian gods were simply transposed to relate to the Hebrew god Jehovah. In Bloodline of the Holy Grail it was related that the modern style of Christianity, which evolved from the Roman Church in the 4th century, was actually a created hybrid, a religion based on themes from numerous others including, of course, Judaism. Now it transpires that Judaism itself was no less of a hybrid in the early days, being a composite of Egyptian, Canaanite, and Mesopotamian traditions, with the stories, hymns, prayers, and rituals of the various and sundry gods brought together and related to a newly contrived one-god concept. What is particularly interesting is that, historically, this was not fully contrived in the time of Abraham, nor even in the later time of Moses. It did not happen until the 6th century BC, when tens of thousands of Israelites were held captive by Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. Until that time, the Hebrew and Israelite records referred to any number of gods and goddesses by individual names, and under a general plural classification of the Elohim. Through some 500 years from the captivity, the scriptures existed only as a series of quite separate writings, and it was not until after the time of Jesus that these were collated into a single volume. Jesus would himself never have heard of the Old Testament or the Bible, but the scriptures to which he had access included many books that were not selected for the compilation that we know today. Strangely though, some of these are still mentioned in the modern Bible text as being important to the original culture, including the enigmatic book of Jasher. Jasher was the Egyptian-born son of Caleb, he was brother-in-law to the first Israelite judge Othniel and an uncle of Bezalel the master craftsman, as well as being the appointed staff-bearer to Moses. It is generally reckoned that the book of Jasher's position in the Bible should be between the books of Deuteronomy and Joshua, but it was sidestepped by the editors because it sheds a very different light on the sequence of events at Mount Horeb in Sinai. The familiar Exodus account explains that Jehovah issued instructions to Moses concerning masters and servants, covetousness, neighborly behavior, crime, marriage, morality, and many other issues including the all-important rule of the Sabbath, along with the Ten Commandments. But, in Jasher, which predates the Exodus writings, these laws and ordinances are not conveyed to Moses by Jehovah. In fact, Jehovah is not mentioned at all. The new laws, says the book of Jasher, were communicated to Moses and the Israelites by Jethro, high priest of Midian and lord of the mountain. In effect, Jethro, whose daughter, Zipporah, Moses married, was the overall governor of the Sinai temple. In Canaan, the title Lord, or Lofty One, of the mountain, was defined as El Shaddai, and this is particularly significant for, as previously mentioned, this was precisely the name related to Moses when he asked the Lord to reveal his identity. The Lord said, "I am that I am, Yahweh, I am he that Abraham called El Shaddai." Yahweh became eventually transposed to the name Jehovah, but, as related in Jasher, and as confirmed in Exodus when correctly read, this Lord was not a deiform God at all, he was Jethro the El Shaddai, the great Vulcan and master craftsman of the Hathor temple. Another very important aspect of the book of Jasher is that it explains that it was not Moses who was the spiritual leader of the tribes who left Egypt for Sinai, their spiritual leader and chief counselor was Miriam, the half-sister of Moses who receives only passing mentions in the book of Exodus. Indeed, as detailed in Jasher, Miriam's position posed such a problem for Moses in his attempt to create an environment of male dominance that he imprisoned her, as a result of which the Israelites rose up against Moses to secure her release. There is no doubt that, for all the scribal manipulation of old texts, Miriam, Mariamon of Egypt, emerges outside the canonical Bible as a key character of the era, but, just like Mary Magdalene in New Testament times, she has been ignored and forgotten by church establishments founded as male-dominated institutions. Of Miriam, the Book of Aaron, credited to her, the grandfather of Bezalel, relates. Miriam from hence became the admired of the Hebrews, every tongue sang of her praise. She taught Israel, she tutored the children of Jacob and the people called her, by way of eminence, the teacher. She studied the good of the nation, and Aaron and the people hearkened unto her. To her the people bowed, to her the afflicted came. The true relevance of Miriam, however, is that she was a recognized dragon queen of the matrilinear Grail bloodline. It was primarily from her that the dynastic line ensued to culminate in the royal house of David, which owes its kingly origin to Miriam's pharaonic descent, rather than to any patriarchal heritage from Abraham, as we are generally led to believe. In the context of this investigation, we have stepped beyond the bounds of the Bible to witness the alchemical and scientific process which facilitated the genesis of the Grail Kings. This line of succession, from Cain and the Mesopotamian dynasts, through the early pharaohs of Egypt, to King David and onward to Jesus, was purpose-bred to be the earthly purveyors of the light. They were the true sons of the gods, who were fed firstly on an Anunnaki star fire from about 3800 BC and, subsequently, on high-spin metal supplements from about 2000 BC. In short, they were bred to be leaders of humankind and they were physically and spiritually maintained in the high ward state, the ultimate dimension of the missing 44%, the dimension of the orbit of light, the plane of Sharon. Only during the past 150 years or so, and more specifically during the past 80 years, have the great storehouses of Egyptian, Mesopotamian, Syrian, and Canaanite record been unearthed from beneath the desert sands. First-hand documentary evidence from before Bible times has now emerged on stone, clay, parchment, and papyrus, tens of thousands of documents which bear witness to a far more exciting history than we were ever told. Had these records been available throughout the generations, the concept of a particular race enjoying a single divine revelation would never have arisen, and the exclusivity of Jehovah, which has blinded us for the longest time, setting us in warlike fashion against those of other faiths who follow their own traditions, would never have taken such an arrogant hold. Gradually, as new discoveries are made, it is evident that we are now emerging from the darkness of our preconceived, but unfounded, notions. Even so, the centuries of church-led indoctrination make it very difficult to discard the restrictive dogma of inbred third-hand tradition in favor of a greater enlightenment from those who were there at the time. The truly inspiring prospect is that the learning curve has still not ended. Just as a single glacier is but a continuation of age-old activity, so too are the ancient wisdoms that now fall to us one by one, with each new facet of learning ready to be stacked upon the former knowledge. Fortunately, the dawn of consciousness is already behind us and, although some will choose to look backwards beyond its veil, many will step with vigor into the new millennium to witness a bright new sunrise, a revelation of unbounded possibility, and a restoration of our true universal inheritance.